Start working. Hi everyone, my name is Elizabeth Foster. I'm the founder of Connect Coach, and Connect Coach is really a platform where we support coaches in getting their messages out there, and we support them with a coach match system and with lots of other things. Actually, we promote them, and the other thing we do is we get some amazing people to come in and support them in actually helping grow their businesses by teaching them stuff. And today we're really privileged. We actually have the most amazing guy. I'm really excited about today's session. We have the most amazing guy. His name is Michael Roderick, and the moment I met Michael, he fascinated me in so many ways, because the way that he teaches about connection just resonated so deeply with who I am and what I do. And that is, you know, that in itself is really powerful. So what we're gonna do, I have to say we have a few slight technical challenges today. And I don't even think that Mercury is in retrograde. And just bear with me a minute. So we are, what we're going to be doing is, for some reason, you can hear me, but you can't hear Michael. And actually, please let me know if you can hear Michael, because that would be kind of cool. We're hoping you can. And if not, we're still going to deliver you the information, and Michael's still going to be talking to you. Just sometimes, you know, technology works really well, and other times it's, when it doesn't, it's a huge challenge. So I am going to do what I can right now, and I'm going to mute myself, and I'm just going to say welcome to Michael. Michael, thank you so much for coming here. Maybe you can have a go at speaking, Michael. Maybe you can.
Do you want to try? Can you hear me okay right now?
I can hear you. I can hear you on the phone. I can't hear you on the computer. Can you hear him on the computer?
No.
You can't? Okay. All right. So, yeah, technical glitches, but that's okay. Anyway, welcome, welcome. Thank you for coming in. At least we're gonna get there. You know, it's just about life. You know, life doesn't always go the way you want it to. Life sometimes just comes in and it just gives you a whole new interesting side to things. So, Michael, tell me, how did you? I was fascinated by your background, because you were once, is it right? You were once a Broadway producer, which is actually really cool. So tell me a little bit about how that even came to be.
Sure. I actually started out, I was a high school English teacher first, and I was really involved in the theater world. I was doing a lot of work within sort of the off-Broadway space and shows and projects. And I was at a party, and I had seen a producer who had spoken on a panel, and I went up to that producer and I just kind of said, you know, I really admire the work that you do. I think it's really awesome. I've been starting to produce myself on these smaller levels, and she asked me pretty much right away what I was doing that week, and I said, you know, I've got a couple shows to see, you know, nothing major, and she invited me to a meeting at the Broadway League, and I ended up meeting a bunch of other producers, and then found that basically the core aspect of Broadway producing is raising money. So I found a couple of producers that I could work with, and I started going out, I started raising money, started getting some credibility in that space. And from there, next thing I knew, I was being offered credit on different projects, and I ended up going from being a high school English teacher to a Broadway producer in under 2 years.
Wow, that's quite something. And so I'm really guessing that what happened, you know, And I'm kind of assuming that that level of, you know, what enabled you to go from being that teacher to a Broadway producer was very much in alignment with who you are, your connecting abilities, and you really, maybe that's where it all was birthed.
Well, I think, you know, it's definitely something you learn a lot over time about just relationships and building relationships. And the whole reason I started my business was I had so many people asking me how I was getting in these doors and how I was making these things happen. And I've always been very curious about why we say yes to things. What is the psychology beyond that? So what I started to do was I started to host workshops where I would simulate these experiences. So using my theater background, I would have people actually act out scenarios in which they were either at a cocktail party or act out a job interview or act out a one-on-one meeting. And then I talked to them about what were they experiencing and what were they noticing. And that really led to me starting to notice a lot of patterns, which then moved me to start to say, okay, well, based on these patterns, I can start to develop some frameworks that others can follow. And that's really where I started getting more into this sort of networking, connecting space. And because I was doing so much study of people, when I would meet people, I'd be able to often see, like, oh, okay, this is the type of person this is, and this is what they're looking for. Let me see how I can help them and support them and what I can do in those dynamics.
So this really came actually out of you being actually incredibly observant. It's what it sounds like. You really, you watched people, and you figured out a lot of stuff, and then you kind of put it together, and now you've got this, the most incredible process, which is just phenomenal. So maybe at the end we'll go back around to a couple of other questions, but I'd love for actually just to jump right in. I've actually asked hopefully can everyone who's actually listening, can you just type in the box, can you hear Michael okay? Can you see Michael okay? Because we do have a few people. For some reason, yes, you can. Okay, great. There's a little echo, but you can hear him. Yeah, thanks, Anthony. I'm sorry about the echo. That's actually because he's on my phone. You can see him and you can hear him, but it's a bit distance. I know. I don't know what we can do. I mean, hopefully the recording, you know, will be a little better. But anyway, it's a bit echoey. We were hoping that it would all be. It would all be fine, but it might not be. So, Michael, I'm going to try and put you onto presenter mode. Do you have the presentation as a PDF, or rather than me sharing my screen? I mean, because maybe that might just switch the system, and then all of a sudden, the sound will kick in. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, I have it. Let me see if I can pull that.
So also, everyone, if you have any questions for Michael, please feel free to ask. He's going to be talking about his whole system, and actually what I found fascinating was that he created it from I kind of call it, and maybe I'm wrong here, but I kind of call it, it's networking, according to your, almost like according to your personality type. Is that about right, Michael?
Yeah, I think that's what it really comes down to. It comes down to using frameworks rather than formulas. I think the challenge for a lot of people is that they end up seeing somebody saying, like, this is the way to network or this is the way to connect, and it doesn't necessarily take into account the personality that they have and where they're comfortable. Yeah. So when you have frameworks, rather than saying, like, do it this way, you're saying, think about it this way, it changes, it definitely changes that dynamic.
I hear it. It's cool. And I like that. I like that idea. Because actually, it's very much in alignment with the coach match system that I use, because I match people according to their types as well. So actually, you and I, we're very similar in that fact. You just do it with connecting and networking, or dare we not? We don't say networking anymore.
Yeah. A lot of folks have issues with that, with that term now, for any number of reasons, yeah. Right? Start dealing with that.
I hear you.
So I have it as a PDF.
Okay, excellent. So I'm going to try making you a presenter, and then what you need to do is on the left-hand side, there's a little thing that says share your screen. So you're now the presenter. You should now be the presenter.
Okay.
And then on the left, there's a little green arrow thing that says share screen.
Yep. Gotcha.
So have a go at that. Hi, can everyone hear me now? Hopefully you can all hear me now. Is that a yes? Can somebody tell me if you can hear me? Yes, you can. Okay, perfect. All right, great. Okay, so apparently when I go on to the audio is back. Okay, so this is what we've got going on. So, okay, Michael, so you've got control of the screen. And they can hear me, but they I'm going to turn my camera off. And then what can happen? And then okay, so now I'm handing over to you. And so it's over to you. Okay, we're good. We got there in the end. All right, thank you. Thank you, everyone, for your patience.
No worries.
Yep, so you're good to go.
So, I'm good to go? Okay, great. So the agenda of what we're going to talk about today, and feel free to ask questions because I can only see my screen. I can't see your questions. I'm sure Elizabeth will pop in and stop me if there are things that you guys want to go deeper into and have more of a conversation about. But we're basically going to talk about a series of things today. The first is this concept I like to refer to as the ocean of events. Then we're going to discuss the ABCD evaluation model. And this is basically a system that you can use to really think more carefully about who you bring into your life, what that process is, how that works for you. Then we're going to get into this aspect of one-on-one meetings. And we're going to look at how do you deepen those one-on-one meetings? How do you really make them something that you have more conversations, more opportunities with? Then we're going to talk about this interesting thing called the TCM index, and basically ties into all of the different things that pop into someone's mind when they're thinking about what they want. We're going to finish off with how to give a good referral and also how to ask for referrals, because that's often a big question that a lot of people have. And from there, we'll just kind of go through questions and all those types of things. And again, as I said, as I go through this process, feel free to interrupt me at any time if there is something that you want more clarification on or you want me to sort of go through in a more in-depth way. So we're going to start with this idea of the events ocean. It's basically the metaphor for any kind of event, is I want you to think about it like the ocean. And within the ocean, there are different archetypes. And in every single event that you go to, you're going to encounter certain archetypes. So what we're going to do is we're going to walk through the archetypes. And in some cases, you've probably already experienced this yourself at an event. You've met some of these archetypes. In some cases, you may identify with one of those archetypes. But understanding who's actually in that room and really being able to break it down can be a great way to just feel more comfortable. I think a lot of people, when they think about going to an event, it can feel awkward, it can feel frustrating, it can feel sometimes overwhelming. And what I've found is that using these archetypes and understanding them really helps you get your bearings when you first get into the room. So the very first archetype that you're going to encounter is the shark. And basically, the thing you have to remember about sharks are these are individuals who, they're all about them. That is their MO. That's the way they do it. So if you've ever been to an event, the person who is jamming business cards in everybody's hands, even if they're not being requested, that's a shark. You'll also notice a shark because they tend to dominate conversation. So you're sitting there, you're talking to somebody, and if a shark comes over, chances are you're going to not get to talk nearly as much because the shark is going to want to steer the conversation to them. Many, many times you'll say something, it could even be something as simple as, oh, you know, I really like this conference, I really like this event. And a shark is very likely to come over and say, oh, well, you know, I don't think this event is that great. I was just at this other event, and then they talk about the other event forever. And the other thing that's really important to note about sharks, and very similar to actual sharks, is the idea of the darting eyes. So when you meet a shark, they almost never look at you the whole time. And you'll notice that. They don't hold eye contact because they're looking around the room most of the time to try and find somebody else who is a better fit for them, is more interesting to them, is more important in their mindset. You'll notice that sharks, if you're at an event and you are wearing a name tag, you'll notice that a shark actually like looks down at your name tag and makes an evaluation based on that information. That's the first type that you'll see are the sharks. The next group that you'll encounter are the dolphins. And dolphins are the people who come to these events and they actually make it a point to cluster. So they've been probably together. Maybe they met before the event. Maybe some of them met at the event. But you'll notice it because they basically get into these small groups, and it's really, really hard to get into that circle. And they're usually having a relatively deep conversation, or they're having a very engaged conversation. And a lot of the time, you'll notice that if they're sort of fitting into this dolphin archetype, their focus is on each other. You won't see them focusing outside of the circle. You won't see them focusing on any other part of the room. Dolphins are often the group that are responsible for when a speaker is about to speak and you're trying to figure out who it is that's talking while the speaker's trying to get the room quiet. That often is a cluster of dolphins because they're just all about their own conversation and sort of their own process. And for many people, when they first go into these rooms, that's a major challenge because you see these clusters. So your natural thought is, how am I ever going to sort of break into that? How am I going to deal with that? Which leads very well into the next group, which are those who are drowning. And if you've ever been in an event and you felt kind of awkward or you felt like you just wanted to leave, chances are you felt like those who are drowning because these are the people at the event who are not necessarily having a good time, right? You may see them standing alone with their phone. Another very common thing with those who are drowning is you'll actually notice them standing outside of a cluster of dolphins. So there will be four people talking, and this person will be standing on the outside, kind of waiting to be invited in, but nobody's inviting them in, so they're just kind of standing there awkwardly, and they're not sure what to do. They're not sure whether they should leave. They're not sure whether they should interrupt the conversation. And maybe in your life, you've also had that kind of experience. So the other side is a lot of the time, that individual is likely to get trapped by a shark. Because, again, sharks want the attention. They want to talk as much as humanly possible. They want all the attention and sort of focus to be on them. So if they find somebody who isn't really asserting themselves, who isn't really connecting with a lot of other people, they're just going to sort of take over. And that is what ends up happening with those who are drowning. Now, the interesting thing is that if you are really concerned about being at an event and you feel like you're alone, you feel like a person who's drowning, one of the best things that you can do is actually be the last form of archetype, which are lifeguards. And what lifeguards do is they look around the room for people who are not feeling comfortable. So they'll take a look and they'll basically say, okay, where are there people standing looking at their phone? Where are there people outside of a group of dolphins? If they are there people sort of standing by the bathroom? Are they sitting by themselves? Are they by the bar? Are they nervously, you know, standing there and eating some food? And one of the best ways to overcome your own nerves at an event, let's say you go to an event and you are feeling really kind of anxious at that event, one of the best ways to fix that is to actually be a lifeguard. So when you're standing there alone, there's a very good chance that there are other people in the room who are also standing there alone, or who are being eaten by a shark, or who are dealing with any number of challenges. And if you go up to that person, the odds of them saying, I don't want to talk to you, I'm not interested in talking to you, are very, very slim. You're always going to find some people who they do just want to be alone, and they don't want to talk to you. But for the most part, most people are really grateful to have somebody come up to them and start a conversation. And I remember myself, when I was first getting started, and I was doing a lot of theater work, and I was working on shows and working on projects, there were events that I would go to where I knew nobody. And I was uncomfortable, and I was freaked out by the fact that I knew nobody. And I'm standing there, and often the way that event would turn around would be somebody would see me who had knew me or had met me before and come up and say, like, hey, how are you doing? Let me introduce you to this person. Let me put you in touch. And it would really change that social dynamic in terms of the event itself. So these are all of the different archetypes that you're going to encounter when you're dealing with these large scale events. And again, that could be a conference, that could be a cocktail gathering that was put on by one of your colleagues or one of your friends. And the best thing that you can do if you're feeling nervous is to be a lifeguard. But the other thing that's important too is you want to look at each of these archetypes. You want to ask yourself, have I been any of these archetypes? It's very easy, especially when you've got something you're proud of or when you've got something you're excited by, to not really catch yourself and to be a shark and to try to dominate the conversation and then make sure that everybody listens to you and all those different types of things. So it's important to be aware. It's the same thing with dolphins. If you are clustered with a group of people, pay attention to the folks on the outside and the fact that they might be trying to get into that conversation. I always, when I'm in a cluster, I always try to make it a point to look around at some point while I'm talking in that cluster to make sure that there isn't somebody standing on the outside who's feeling uncomfortable. And often I'll turn to that person if they are, and I'll basically kind of open up the circle and I'll say, "Hey, how are you? I'm Michael. What are you doing at this event? How do you like it?" All these types of things, and I'll bring them kind of into the circle, and it'll help them to feel better. And it's often a good thing to do. So really important to pay attention to what archetypes you fall into, and also really important to look at how you're going to be helpful to the people in the room, especially if you're nervous. If you're nervous, the thing that's going to take those nerves down 100 notches is helping somebody else. The second that you put yourself in this position to help somebody else, you're going to feel a lot of those nerves go away because you move from selling yourself to basically just helping and supporting. So any questions about those archetypes or that process before we move on?
There's no questions at the moment, just to let you know.
Okay.
No questions. I can't see any questions anyway.
Okay, fantastic. So I'll just move right on to one-on-one meetings. So you've gone to the event, you've gotten this person's card, they've reached out to you or you've reached out to them, and they've basically said, "Let's get together." And now you're going to meet with people. And one of the dangers, and I did this when I first got started, is taking every single meeting and treating every single meeting in the exact same way. So basically saying, okay, I'm going to go to this meeting, I'm going to find out what I can find out about this person, I'm going to see where business opportunities could sort of come out of it, and I'm just going to meet as many people as possible. And what I learned when I was doing that, I was sometimes taking 7 or 8 meetings a day. And in many cases, I didn't have much time to get my own work done. And in a lot of cases, I realized that there were actually a lot of different types of people out there. And some I really enjoyed spending more time with than others. So what I've developed a grading system that you can use when you have one-on-one meetings so that you can start to think about who is the person that you met. And do you want to continue to spend more time and build that relationship? So we're going to go through each of them. And the first group are the A's. And the A's refer to the advocates. Now, you'll notice an advocate because they are a fan of whatever it is your business is. They'll ask you a bunch of questions. They're very curious people. They're very, very thoughtful. You'll also notice advocates because they love to offer to help, and they often will offer to make introductions. And a lot of really solid connectors are also really good advocates because they listen and they pay close attention. The other thing that advocates can do is that they'll spread the word about your work. So you'll know that you've encountered an advocate because maybe they'll be commenting on social media about you. Maybe they'll share your material. They'll tell their friends. They'll invite you maybe to speak or do something. So advocates are the type of people that you want in your life. And you'll know during that meeting whether or not you're dealing with an advocate, because if you're dealing with an advocate, the meeting will be mainly about you. It will be tough for you to really get a ton of information out of the other person because advocates are very, very bad, often at advocating for themselves. So you'll know you're dealing with an advocate because they're spending most of the time having the conversation about you and how they can help and how they can support you. As opposed to really kind of seeing what they can do for themselves and, your life, you'll find that there are people, they love to help you, they love to support you, and you'll be frustrated with them because they'll never let you know what it is that they actually need or what it is that they're actually looking for. So with those people, you kind of have to push a little bit and say, you know, what is it that you're working on, and how can I understand more of your world and what you're doing? And sometimes you have to push a little bit because all they want to do is help. So if we could all live in a world with advocates, that would be wonderful, and we'd have a fantastic time, and all of our meetings would be great, and we'd want to meet all the time, but we don't meet advocates all the time. The most common group that you're going to meet, and if you've ever been part of a networking-focused organization, you've probably met people who fit this next category, which are boomerangs. So boomerangs are incredibly focused on reciprocity. These people are not going to do anything unless they can see a mutual benefit. They'll often start their conversations around mutual benefit. The other thing about boomerangs is it's very rare that they'll reach out to you. They're always going to kind of look for you to send them something, do something, you know, et cetera. Before they help you. You'll also notice when you're explaining what you do, if you get the opportunity to give them a little bit of a breakdown of your business and your prospects and your process, they will politely listen before they pitch you. So you'll notice polite listening versus actual active listening, because polite listening, you can see somebody basically just nodding every time you say something. They're never asking you additional questions. They're like, yep, 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 yep. They don't really get into it at all. And as soon as you finish, they pitch whatever their service is. The last thing about boomerangs is they very, very commonly will give you something of equal or lesser value when you make an offer. So let's say you're meeting with a boomerang and you offer to introduce them to the head of a company where they can get a speaking engagement. Now, for them, that could be a really great opportunity. It could be a very solid possibility. They're likely to basically say, okay, you introduced me to a speaking opportunity, so I'm going to introduce you to a speaking opportunity. They don't often think outside of the box on that end. And a lot of times, like, you'll put them in touch with the head of a company, and it'll be a really solid, warm, powerful introduction, and they'll say, oh yeah, you should talk to this person. And in some cases, they haven't even talked to that person about you or about your service. So you'll notice it because boomerangs are just very, very focused on how can this be a two-way meeting. And you'll notice that it's really split down the middle. They're not gonna spend a lot of time asking you any questions or dealing with you in any concrete way. The next group are part one of the C's. And this is important when you're in business, because when you're having a one-on-one meeting with somebody, you really want to ask yourself, is this somebody who actually could be a potential client? Now, every once in a while, you are going to have a nice warm intro that's going to set something up. But sometimes you'll have a get-together meeting or I'm getting to know you meeting, and you'll be able to understand that there is something that you can help this person with and that they're open to that idea. And I'm going to break down how you can get a better sense of whether or not this person is a client, because I think the mistake that a lot of people make when they're sitting down with someone who could be a potential client is that they make a lot of assumptions about that process. So the first thing to remember is they're experiencing some kind of pain that they communicate, right? So they're letting you know about an issue or a challenge that they're having, and if they're going to be a potential client, it's something that you can actually solve, right? So if they're explaining a pain point and you're able to help or support in some way, that's a great time to show your expertise, right? That's a great time to give them some advice or give them some thoughts on this process, because it shows them that you know what you're talking about, and it gives them a little bit more of a sense of the work that you do. C second, and this is really, really important, they show genuine inquiry. And the best way that I like to think about genuine inquiry is when you explain what you do, how do they respond? So if you say, I sell insurance, and they say, that sounds great, obviously they are not really interested in you selling insurance to them. But if you say, I sell insurance, and they say, wow, you know, I've been thinking a ton about insurance recently because I just had a major life event, and you know, a lot of my friends are telling me I should work with an insurance agent, but I'm not sure because I've had all these issues. That's genuine inquiry. They're saying to you, I want to know, like, what does it mean to work with you? You'll also notice genuine inquiry because somebody will say, but what would the cost be, and what's the process, and how does this all work? But if they don't show genuine inquiry, stop putting them in the category of client and stop going through the pitch process because it's kind of a waste of your time. The next thing that's really important is they see the value in what you do. Right? When you explain what it is, they say, oh yeah, that's something that not only I think I need, but I think that's something other people need. And very, very often, clients will say at some point in the conversation that they want to work with you. If they're trying to decide, if they're thinking about it, every once in a while, somebody might walk away and let you know later. But most of the time, if it's a client, if they really fall into that client category, they're going to ask you questions about, well, how do we, like, if I were to hire you, how would we work together? And they start giving these hypotheticals, and that's usually the way to figure it out. But the mistake that most people will make within an introductory meeting is to assume that the person is a client, is interested in being a client, and that the person is interested in genuine inquiry. And that can be a real mess when you're going through that process. Two of the C's are the celebrities. Now, it's really important to note that basically everyone is a celebrity to somebody, but celebrity is relative to everybody. So, yes, there are people who we recognize as celebrities, and we say, wow, that person's famous because I read about them in Forbes, I saw them on TV. But that person is also somebody's cousin. That person is also somebody's best friend. That person has a certain amount of credibility in one industry but doesn't have any credibility in another. There's lots of ways to define celebrities. But there are a couple of things to keep in mind if you are encountering a celebrity in your one-on-one meeting. You notice that if you say that you know them, people are impressed. So if you mention the name, people are like, wow, how did you get to know this particular person? Often, even when you get an intro to them, somebody will usually send like a laundry list of accomplishments or a link that lets you know, like, the person, you know, done a lot. To that point, they're accomplished and known in an industry. So there's usually content out there about them. They've written a lot of different things. They can make things happen faster. Celebrities, because of the fact that they've developed these really deep relationships, many times can get you in a door that you may not be able to get into because they have that credibility already. And often a celebrity can help with that process. But the other really important thing to note is if you're meeting with a celebrity is that they have little time. So don't be worried if you're having a meeting with somebody who's really accomplished and they're moving really fast through the meeting. It doesn't necessarily always mean that they're not interested or that they're rude. It can often mean that their day is timed down to the second. And they want to help. They want to be supportive. They want to connect with you. They want to talk. But they can't afford to have it be a leisurely conversation. Their world is just a quick, very, very fast kind of world. And I think a mistake that a lot of people will make with folks who have that celebrity status is not recognizing that they don't have a ton of time, and putting them out or asking them to do things that will take time. With celebrities, you always want to make things as easy for them as possible because they're just running around so much. Now the last group that you're going to encounter. These are the dreams. Now, it's important to note that you are going to encounter dreams in every situation, in every part of your life. But it's also really important to note that you have probably had a dream at some point in your life. And there will be instances in which you'll meet somebody and they'll be a dream in the meeting, but somewhere down the line, they won't be like that. Maybe they were going through something. Maybe they were going through a process. You know, other times you were encountering somebody who is just, it's all about them. And you want to spend as little time as possible dealing with those meetings because you're not really going to get much out of it. And you're going to feel physically and emotionally drained by the end of the process. So how do you spot a drain? How do you really think about that? The first thing is the entire meeting is basically about them. So you'll open and maybe you'll say one or two things, but dreams will very often hijack the meeting. So they will tell you as many stories about themselves as possible. They'll just talk about all sorts of different things that they offer and that they are, you know, all those different types of dynamics, and they'll pretty much never ask you about you. Another very, very key thing about dreams is they'll ask you for things but never offer. So you'll notice a drain because you never get an email from them or a phone call or a text that says, hey, I found this thing for you. I'd love for you to come to this or check this thing out. But you'll always get an email or a phone call saying, hey, can you do this thing for me? And usually they'll play it off as like, this is just something really simple, really quick. Another way that you know that you're dealing with a drain is they argue with you in a meeting. If they are just not really listening to you and not really paying attention to what you have to say, and then they push back and they argue with you, that's going to drain you of your energy. You do not need to defend your business or yourself to someone. If they're not really interested in what you do or if they don't like what you do, you know, you don't need them in your life. And I use the word argue because it's very different than somebody having an informed conversation. Like, yes, people will disagree with you, and that's totally fine, but argument means that some emotion's attached to it, and it's pushy, and it's annoying, and that's just not what you want in your life. Then the last thing that you'll notice, specifically about dreams, is they'll try to sell to you even when there's no genuine inquiry. So even though you have not said anything about liking their service, anything about wanting to buy what they have to offer, they will still try to tell you all of the features and the benefits and all the reasons why you should buy, you know, whatever it is that they have. Once you go through this process, and that's the last group, and once you go through this process, it's going to be easy for you if after a meeting you sit down and you just document it for yourself and say, did I meet an A, a B, a C, or a D? Because now you can start to look at patterns. So for me, when I get a new introduction or if somebody connects me to somebody, I often will go to their LinkedIn profile and I'll look at who they are connected to. And if they're basically surrounded by drains, I know the kind of meeting that I'm probably going to have. If they're surrounded by boomerangs, I know the meeting that I'm going to have. If they're surrounded by celebrities, I know the meeting that I'm going to have. If they're surrounded by the people who fit the client profile for me, I know that this is probably somebody who is a potential lead or somebody who might be interested in from a business standpoint. And if they're surrounded by advocates, I know for the most part that I'm going to encounter advocates. Now, are you going to every once in a while have people that don't fit into these categories or shift these categories? Of course. But if you're paying attention to it and you're paying attention to where these people are coming from, you can actually be much more thoughtful about which meetings you decide to take and what you do with those meetings and sort of how you handle those meetings. And that's everything for the ABCD process. I'm going to stop there to check and see if anybody has any questions about that process before I talk about how this process relates to time.
Okay, so Michael, actually, we had a question earlier from... it was Dawn, and she was asking, and that was regarding to the sharks and dolphins. She said, how do you actually break away from a shark?
That's an excellent, excellent question. I think a lot of people deal with that. One is to really create a firm exit So in some cases, it can be as simple as, you know, it was really nice meeting you. And really just kind of like giving them language that helps them understand that that conversation is over. In some cases, you can also frame something as, you know, let me give you my card, and why don't we find the time to finish this conversation? And, you know, then it's like you can sort of step away. Another one that works really well is, you know, we all have to go to the bathroom. So one of my favorites is to basically say, you know what, I gotta run to the bathroom. I'll be back. And because it's an event, very, very rarely is anybody gonna like still try to find you. The other thing that's really important about a shark is it's not really important that you're there. It's just important that somebody's there to give them the attention. So very often, if you say you have to leave, a shark doesn't care. Most of the time we worry about, am I going to offend this person? Are they going to feel bad? You know, are they going to feel bad? No. For the most part, they just care about telling the story. So if you say, I got to run to the bathroom, or I'm going to go grab something to eat, and you don't come back, they don't care. They're not really looking at it from, you know, from that angle. So I would always say, if you're stuck with a shark, look for what are those avenues and what are those techniques that will get you out of there quickly. So that could be bathroom, that could be offering to chat at a later time. Another thing that has often worked well is pulling other people into the circle. And basically, like, you see somebody else that you know, and you guys start getting into a conversation, because sometimes you can overpower a shark by having four or five people that are kind of on your team. So now you're all talking to each other, so now the shark's not dominating the conversation anymore. There's a lot of different ways to play it, but the core thing is, if you are not happy with the situation and you are trapped, you need to do something to get yourself out of that situation. Otherwise, you will be basically standing with a shark all night.
Wow, and actually, I've been in that situation, so I wish I'd listened to this. I had this information earlier, because I have been pinned down by sharks on more than one occasion, and it's just like, how do you do it? So thank you, Dawn, for asking that question, and I love it. Thank you, and it makes sense, of course. You know, what are they going to say? Like, no, you can't go to the bathroom. Of course, you can.
Yeah, right.
So Jen was also asking, what's the best way to deal with different types? Jen, maybe could you be a little bit more specific with that question? Or Michael, can you take it from there? I mean, what's the best way of dealing with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that depending on the type that you're dealing with, you want to think, are we referring to the types at the event, or are we referring to the ABCD folks before I go too deep into it?
Jen, can you respond to that? She didn't actually say. She just said, okay. I don't know that. I don't have that information. She's not answering just yet.
So what I'll do is I'll just kind of give a very brief for both, you know, in terms of how you deal with the different types. So we already sort of talked about the shark dynamic. In the dolphin situation, you have two choices with dolphins. You can either break into the conversation, which is your option. If you decide that you want to break into a conversation, the best thing to do is look at the feet of the people who are clustered. Very often there's one person who's a little bit turned away from the group. And if that person's turned away, it means that they're not as focused as the rest of the dolphins, which means that's an opening for you to go in and introduce yourself and say hello. I've had many, many instances where I've noticed somebody who wasn't as engaged in the rest of the conversation in a dolphin cluster, where I've been able to go up to them and say hello. And in some cases, they've broken away from that cluster, or they've brought me into the cluster in that particular side of things. Obviously, if you're dealing with people who are drowning, best thing is to look at what's going on and try to assess the situation and just ask them some very friendly questions and just test where are they at. So some people, they're a they want to be alone. And when you ask them, you know, so what brought you to this event, or, you know, a basic sort of opening question, what did you think of the last speaker, whatever it is, the way that they answer is going to tell you how open they are to conversation. And one of the things that we forget a lot of the time is that if somebody wants us to go away, they will basically start to decrease their the number of words that they use in their sentences. So they'll start answering in one sentence. And it's basically a cue that they are not interested in what, you know, in what we have to say and what we have to offer. So if somebody starts to get more verbose, then you know that they want to keep the conversation going. So if you say, what brought you to this event? It's like, I don't know. Then you're like, oh, so what did you think of the last speaker? I guess they were okay. You're going to notice that that person doesn't really want to continue the conversation. So you can move, you can kind of move from there. And then with other lifeguards, like if you find other lifeguards, like go out and like start creating your own clusters and making things happen on that dynamic.
Okay, thanks, Michael, cool. for clarifying that. It seems kind of simple, but actually, when you say it like that, it makes total sense. It's brilliant. Thank you.
So we're going to move on to how this relates to time, because you really want to think very carefully about how you're handling your time with each of these categories. So with advocates, you're investing time, because these are people who your life is going to be enriched by having advocates with you. So these are people who, if you've had a great meeting, you should not just like put them in your list of people and be like, okay, that person was cool. And maybe I'll catch up with them, some other time. Like, really take the time to stay on their radar, invite them to things, keep them in your circle, because they're going to keep helping you, and you're going to keep helping them, and it's going to grow. So really think about it as a time investment. With boomerangs, you're leveraging your time. I always say with folks who are more of that transactional nature, one-on-one don't really work nearly as well, because it's just so back and forth, and you're not going to have a very deep conversation. So it's better with boomerangs to basically meet them at a group, in a group, or meet them at an event. And there's nothing wrong. I think a lot of people get caught up in this. There's absolutely nothing wrong with saying, hey, do you want to come to this event when you meet somebody, or inviting them to a lunch, or inviting them to a dinner, for the first time. It's totally fine if that's the first time that you're meeting them, because they're going to see that value, but you're also going to be leveraging your time. You're not just sort of saying like, okay, well, let's see where it goes. You know what you're dealing with. The other thing is, a lot of, if you do encounter a number of boomerangs, it's much easier to do a gathering where they're just going to go and sort of be boomerangs the whole time. And it's going to save you time. But if you're meeting one-on-one, you're going to constantly be dealing with that. With your clients, you're investing, because obviously you want them to come to the table and be able to work with you. With celebrities, you're also investing your time, because you develop these relationships with these people. They're going to be advocates for you. They're going to be helpful to you. And it's going to help you when you're going out there and saying, I want to work with this company or that company. CEO, you worked with this person, or you know this person. It adds a level of credibility. Dreams, you're wasting time, and you have to be very, very aware of that. If you are physically and emotionally drained after a meeting, if you feel like you're constantly pushing, in that situation, you really are just, you're wasting your time. And it's really important. I think too many people spend too much time with dreams because we feel bad. I think it's very natural. If you've ever had a meeting where you just feel like you feel bad because the person is telling you their life story and you don't want to interrupt them because you feel like this is what they need right now, but you have to be, you know, thoughtful about your own time. You cannot just spend all that time with these people who are just trying to take things from you and get things from you. You've got to choose where you can do that. Otherwise, you'll run out of time. Any questions about any of that?
No. at this moment in time. I mean, it makes total sense, actually. You know, the drain people. I remember somebody telling me about energy vampires, and the draining people remind me of energy vampires. You know, they're in that place. Mm-hmm. They're in that place that they just suck everything out of you, and they don't leave you with anything. So it kind of reminds me of that.
Yes. Yeah. It's very, very similar, very, very similar type, very, very similar concept. You know, just the whole idea that there are going to be people who they're just in a place in their life where they can't really think about anybody else. They can only think about themselves. And, you know, depending on where they are and what that process is, there's only so much you can do with those people. So.
Yeah.
All righty. And how are we doing on...
Michael? No, that's not good. We just lost Michael. And he can't hear me. Okay. See, Mercury, I know it's not in retrograde, but it's just not there right now. So hang on a second. So I am going to have to call him back. So hang on a second, because he can't hear me because he's muted. Okay. All right. All right, stay with us. Hey, Michael.
Hello.
That was interesting. So it just died for some very strange reason. I'm telling you, we're definitely being technically challenged today. Okay, so we just started. You said any other questions? How are we doing for time? And that's when everything closed down.
Yep.
So we don't have a huge amount of time left. So. Yeah, we've got about, I know that some people have to, you know, they've only reserved an hour, but we can go into it and hopefully we can go over a little bit.
Okay, sure. So I'll just keep going, and you just let me know when we're sort of past the time point.
Okay.
Alrighty. So... Now we're going to talk about the aspect of making your meetings go deeper. So a lot of the time when you have a one-on-one meeting, there is often only one touch point. Most meetings only focus on the professional. And in that professional sort of side of things, you're talking about your business, you're talking about what's a good referral, you're talking about all these things that are business related, and often you don't get to touch on any of these other aspects. And there are multiple other aspects, and this can be really helpful for you if you are in a meeting, and let's say it is a professional meeting, and maybe it's not going well, and you're talking about professional stuff, and it just doesn't seem to be going in any direction. This gives you a couple of other avenues and a couple of other directions that you can go in. So the different types that we're going to talk about are the professional, the personal, the inspirational, the aspirational, and the problematic. So, in the professional situation, you're asking them about their background, you're asking them about business, you're asking them about referral partners, so you're really focused, when you're talking professional, you're really focused on what are the business outcomes that this person is looking for, what is it that you're trying to accomplish with them, and help them with, and it's very, very focused on business. Now, most of us never go beyond there, but one of the best ways to really connect with people is to go deeper, and the personal is an amazing opportunity for that. And I think a lot of the time we see the word personal and we think, oh, well, I don't want to seem like a stalker. I don't want to seem like I'm, you know, getting into somebody's business. So it doesn't have to be this like hyper personal, like tell me about your last breakup kind of thing. It can be something as simple as where is it that they're living? You know, if they mention family, a great question could be, oh, you know, how old is your daughter? You know, just little things. And a lot of the time, those things open up a lot of other aspects. I also find that on the personal level, food is a great conversation starter. So if you're at a coffee shop, or maybe you're meeting for lunch, or you're meeting somewhere where there is some kind of food dynamic, asking people about what they're eating and drinking and why, there are tons of people who they just like love that story. The other aspect is, what do they do for fun? Like, what do they enjoy? Is it, you know, it's a good thing? What kind of challenges are coming up and that they're currently thinking about or worried about? So these aren't business challenges. These might be personal challenges. For some people, it's, you know, I feel like I'm overwhelmed right now. For other people, some personal challenges might be, I just moved to a new city and I don't feel, you know, very comfortable being here. There's lots of directions you can go with that. The next one is the inspirational. And this is another one that very few people really ask about. And I think that in almost every conversation that you have, people will ask you about what you do, but they very rarely will ask you why you do it. So what it is that causes you to want to do this work. And I have had instances where the conversation has been really kind of quiet and almost dead, but when I ask them why they do this, when I ask them why they started their company or whatever the, you know, situation is, they light up and they tell a much, much deeper story, and it really shifts. The other aspect of inspirational is, what causes do they support? What types of things are exciting to them? There's always causes that people believe in, that they want to be involved in. Some people get really, really strong in sort of their activists kind of side of things. Other people just, you know, they run their marathons and they do those types of things. So really having that conversation. The next one that, again, is a really, really solid one that is often not used is the aspirational. And the aspirational is really tying to this idea of, what do they aspire to? So no matter who you meet, they have some sort of next level. They have some sort of next step they're trying to get to, and I have found that asking people about this is such a powerful tool because it opens them up more. But the other side of it, for you, when you're thinking about connecting, you know what it is that they want next. You know who they want to meet next. You know what their goals are, and you know things that they've always wanted to do. So now, with all that information, there's so many great ways that you can surprise this person or help this person. And then the last one that I think not enough of us talk about is the problematic, which is, what is their biggest challenge? What is their current need? What's some information that they're missing? Now, a lot of the time, you're going to have people be concerned about telling you their problems or telling you their issues because they feel like, well, I don't want to show anybody that I'm struggling or that I need help or, you know, any of those types of things, especially in business situations. So a really great way to get around that is to ask them what the biggest problem is in their industry. If you ask somebody about what they feel the biggest problem is in their industry, most of the time they start talking about their own problems. And they start talking about, they'll talk about the industry, but they'll circle back to their own issues and their own problems. And once you start to understand those problems, there are lots of different ways that you'll be able to help them solve those problems and sort out those issues, find the information that they're missing. And again, it just makes it so that you are so much more of a resource to an individual. And I think it's important to just think for yourself, in whatever business you're in, when I'm taking a meeting, am I a service provider or am I a resource? And if you're a service provider, all you're about is whatever your service is and making sure that people know about that service. And service providers are a dime a dozen. Resources are very, very valuable and they're hard to find. So if you can be a resource instead of a service provider, these questions will help you do that, then you're much more likely to be effective and really make your meeting move in a direction where things work out. Questions about that? I move on.
Any questions, anybody? About those inspirational, aspirational problems? Jen is just saying this is incredibly helpful. I know, isn't he amazing, Jen? This is why I asked him to come on, because he's just the most incredible. I mean, his information is just wild and just helpful for so many people in so many different areas of their lives. So thank you, Michael. Anyway, yes, carry on. I mean, listen, yeah, while no we've worries. Still got people on, I'm happy to keep going.
If that's good with you. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is the TCM index. And basically, every single person that you meet, no matter what industry they're in, no matter what they're involved in, they have concern around time, connections, and money. And the important thing to understand is that depending on who you're talking to, there is a deficit in one of those areas. And this shapes the way that you present your material. This shapes the way that you interact with them. This shapes the things that you offer that are of value to them. This is incredibly powerful. If any of you are in the process of selling, this is an incredibly powerful thing to keep in mind when you're going through a sales process. Because I see this all the time where somebody's selling something and the person's pain point is time, and they're trying to sell them on the pain point of money. They're trying to get this person to say, you know, they're saying, oh, this thing will cost you so much less. And the person doesn't care if it costs them three times as much if it saves them time. And I've seen this in numerous instances. So you really want to get a sense of the index of the person that you're meeting. What is important to them? Is time important to them? Are connections important to them? Is money important to them? Yes, all three are important to every single person, but at different points in our life, different ones are going to be more important than others. And it's great. It's a great tool for yourself. Like, just ask yourself right now, if I look at my own TCM index, where do I feel things are lacking? And here's the most interesting thing about this, and then I'll go into in depth into each of them. But the most interesting thing about this is that if you have a deficit in any one of these things, the other two are actually the key to helping you solve that deficit problem. So let's say you have a deficit in connections. You can invest your time and you can invest your money in better connections, like going to conferences, going to high-profile dinners, going to events that are going to help you build that particular network. Let's say money is a problem and you're not making nearly enough. Investing your time properly and thinking very carefully about which connections are you talking to about your service. It's very possible that you're just not selling to somebody who can really afford that particular service. And your connections are the ones that are going to help you understand who you should talk to and sort of what that process is. And if you are feeling stretched for time, but you have plenty of connections and you have money to help you, then there are all sorts of ways that you can save time. You can find an assistant, you can find somebody to help you, you can hire someone who helps you manage your time. There's so many different types of things that you can do. So going into each of these, a lot of people from the time standpoint, they are feeling very, very stretched. They want to save time. They want to make things faster. Their job is to get through whatever they need to get through as quickly as possible. And if time is their issue, the last thing you want to do is recommend something or offer them something that's going to take them an obscene amount of time. This is particularly important when you're looking at asking somebody to do something. So for those of you, I know that there are lots of coaches who listen to this and are sort of part of this. If your client feels like whatever you're asking them to do or whatever you're asking them to execute on is going to take too much time, often it's not the motivation issue. It's not that they don't want to do it. It's that they see it and they think it's going to take a ridiculous amount of time. And many times when your client is not doing what you want them to do, it really has to do with the fact that they've figured out in their head that whatever you've asked them is going to take way more time than it actually is. So you as the coach have to break it down for them and basically say, no, if you do this for 15 minutes a day and go through a process, it's going to be fine. You do not have to carve out 3 hours to do what I just told you to do. And that's the thing. We stretch time all the time. We really do. Somebody tells us to do something and we think it's going to take us hours. And often it's like a messy room. You look at it and you think you're going to spend all day on it. But if you actually work on it, most of the time it's like 2 hours and you're done. Next one on connections. There are people who right now it's really about meeting certain people to help them achieve their goals. So if somebody's in a business development position, if somebody's selling to a very, very specific type of client, the most important thing in their life and the thing that they're going to be trying to push is how do they get into conversations with those people. And if you are able to help them solve that problem or you're able to do something with that, it can be huge for them. And then the last one, with money, there are some people who it's going to just be about how much money they make, how much money they save. It's a financial thing. And again, your understanding of that is huge. If you are not aware that money is the thing that this person's concerned about and you're trying to sell them on how much time they're going to save or you're trying to sell them on what types of people they're going to meet, it's not going to work. You know, and really taking time to understand that and understand those values is a great way to make sure that you are tapping into the real need of the individual. Because most of the time when we have missed connections or connections that don't work, it has to do with the fact that we didn't listen enough to what the other person needed and we didn't really pay any attention to their TCM index. Any questions about the index?
Not at this moment in time. Does anyone have any questions about time, connections, or money? If you do, post them up.
Great.
Thanks, Michael.
All right. No worries. So we're going to roll into giving a good referral. So here's the thing. Most of the time, people will say that they gave you a referral, and it actually wasn't a referral, right? And it's really important to understand that there is a major difference between a referral, a connection, and a favor. And a referral is when somebody has had a legitimate conversation about your service, the other person has shown genuine inquiry, says that they want to work with you, and then the person sends them your way. That's a real referral. If it's just, hey, you guys should meet each other, that's not a referral, it's a connection. And don't let others misuse that term. If somebody says that they sent you a referral and that person doesn't know anything about your product or your service, you have to have that, you know, conversation with them of that really wasn't a referral and help them understand what it is. And they'll appreciate it and they'll do better. You know, and you would want to know that too. If you're seeing somebody and they're not a referral, but you're calling them a referral, you don't want to be seen as the person who's sending folks their way that aren't really going to make it happen. So how do you really get deep into this so that you can give good referrals? So we're going to break down questions that you can ask. So the first one is, how do they make their money? So whoever you're meeting has a specific system in which they're making their money. If they are an employee of a company, then they have a salary and they have certain things that they have to accomplish so that they don't get fired. So understanding what a referral would be for that person is going to be geared towards, well, what is it that they have to accomplish and how is it that their company, you know, makes that money. So in some cases, they may charge for a service. In some cases, they may have an affiliate relationship where somebody buys a service and then they get a percentage of that. In some cases, they may have a product, but you have to understand how they're making their money. And one of the sort of scary things that happen when you don't ask how they make their money is sometimes other people get surprised by how the person makes their money. So if you don't understand the business model, but you refer somebody and then they sit down with this individual and the business model is a model that they're not a fan of or that they don't like, you can really turn off the other person that you made that intro to. So really paying attention to that is important. The next thing, how much do they charge? And I cannot stress this enough, find out the specifics. Now, here's the thing. Especially if you're in the coaching world and you're meeting another coach or you're meeting another service provider who sort of falls into that coaching world, what's the natural thing they're going to say? They're going to say, well, you know, my rates vary and all this other stuff. The best way to cut through that BS is to basically say, what can I send you that is not a waste of your time? You tell me the number that somebody should be willing to spend that is not a waste of your time. Very, very rarely will anybody not give you a number after that point. Okay. Because you need to know how much this person is charging, especially if you're going to refer, because you don't want somebody that you're referring to get sticker shock. You don't want somebody that's referring not to be able to actually pay for the service, all those different types of things. Another question, and it's amazing how many times this question isn't really asked. Do they want more clients or do they want bigger clients? And the natural sort of knee-jerk reaction of people is I want more clients. But very often it's actually, especially if they're a coach, especially if they're doing one-on-one work, the real thing is that they want bigger clients. They want people who are spending more money, because unless they've got a great system or a great platform to manage all of those clients, it's just going to be a nightmare for them. Now, there are services that want more clients. So if you're talking to somebody who's got a SaaS software as a service company, they are much more likely to say that they want more clients because they're basically getting paid per user. But it's important to understand, do they want more clients or do they want bigger clients? The next question that you can ask, which is really solid and helpful, is pain points. Ask them what issues should I listen for. So in other words, really get deep with this person about, if I were talking to somebody who needed your service, what types of things would they be complaining about to me? How would they be complaining to me? What would they be saying to me that would cause me to say, oh, yes, you need this? So what is the headache that I need to hear about in order to say, like, you have the aspirin? The last note to think about is a referral is simply a problem plus willingness to pay plus consent. If you're really going to give a solid referral, you just have to understand that the person has a problem. You have to understand that the person that you're referring is willing to spend money. Anytime I have a conversation with somebody about whether or not I'm going to refer them business, I always get a better sense of, does the client that I'm talking to, do they have a willingness to pay? And then the last is consent. If the person says, yes, I want to be introduced to your friend and I'm willing to spend money, then make that intro. But do not make an intro that you think is a referral without the other party understanding what they're getting into. None of us want to walk into a meeting and be sold to. We want to walk into a meeting and have a conversation about whether or not somebody can help us solve our problem. We have no interest in being sold to as consumers, as individuals. Nobody ever wants to sit in a meeting and be sold to. So the more that you make that easy for the other individual, if you're giving really good referrals, trust me, you're asking all these questions, these people who you're working with, who are your referral partners, are going to ask those same questions of you. That's going to make it easier for you to get really solid, really powerful referrals. Questions on that before I move into asking for referrals?
Any questions, anybody? Not at the moment. It's all quiet on the Western Front.
All right. So a couple of things to understand with asking for referrals. Advocates are better at giving them. So it's really important to note that the advocates in your life, they care about you. They want to help you. They want to support you. You're much more likely to get referrals from advocates. So if you've got a spreadsheet for yourself, or if you've got a list of people who you identified as advocates from your one-on-one meetings, or you can just think of people in your life where you're like, wow, they're really supportive of what I do. Those are the people to reach out to. If right now, if you were listening to this right now and you were saying, I need referrals right now, the best thing you can do is sit down and write a list of 10 advocates and reach out to those advocates and let them know that you are looking for a very, very specific type of referral and see if they have any ideas or any ways that they can help. And a lot of the time, these people will just like come to you and help you in whatever way they can. Next thing is, how easy is it to explain what you do? Have you packaged it? If you want somebody to refer you business, you have to figure out, how are you solving the problem? And can you put it in a very, very simple way? You do not want to try and tell somebody a paragraph-long description of what you do, because when they go to somebody else, they're going to mess up that paragraph. And in many cases, they're not going to remember it. And one of the core reasons why a lot of, specifically coaches, don't get business is because they don't make it easy to explain, and they haven't packaged it well, and they've gone in like every single direction imaginable. So, you know, the person's like, oh, yes, this person will save your life and scrub your soul and you know, put crystals on you. And like, and next thing you know, you're just like, what is it that this person does? Like, how does this actually help? And it's important when you're thinking about that, how to explain, just think about it in terms of the benefit to the consumer. What are you helping them do? Go back to the TCM. Are you helping them save time? Are you helping them build better relationships, build better connections? Are you helping them make more money? Are you helping them save money? What is it that you're doing that ties to those core needs and those core issues? Next thing to remember is that scarcity moves things faster. So if you have a limited number of whatever it is that you're doing and you have limited timeshare, that's huge and it's incredibly helpful. So when you're thinking about asking for referrals, when you reach out to somebody, you could totally say, you know what, I only have 3 of these packages. And then they're going to tell their friends that. And if they've talked, all their friends are talking, now it's like, okay, they reach out to you. And then you're like, yeah, I've only got 2 left. It's a very, very different mindset. If you're constantly sort of presenting your offering as people can have it whenever, it's much more likely for them to just like not make that choice. And basically be like, oh, well, I can get it whenever. Confirm they see the value. If they can't sell you, it's pointless to sell. Once you've explained what you do to a referral partner or to somebody who's going to refer you business, like, actually ask them, do you see value in this? Like, do you understand? Like, do you see this as useful? And see what they say. And in some cases, they'll say, oh my God, everybody needs this. This is amazing. You know, in other cases, they'll say, you know what, I really don't understand what you do. Now you can really start to get to a better place. And then the last thing is to really frame it around the person that you'd be helping. How are you helping the client? Making that clear explanation. So don't talk about it from the standpoint of, I do this, because it's like a shark. It's bragging. It's like, it's big, it's bold. It's more around the lines of, I help this type of client, or I support this client in this outcome. Get as clear as possible, and you're much more likely to have people want to refer you and help you from a referral standpoint. And that is all she wrote, as they say.
Oh my God, Michael, that is just phenomenal. And I mean that thing that you were talking about around, you know, the coaches, there's 2 things that really stuck out for me. One was, and anybody, if you want to ask any questions, any last minute questions, and you're still on the line, then please, you know, hop in. But there's two things. I mean, one is that conversation around money with coaches. It's such a huge, it's a, such a challenge with them, because they really, they find it very difficult to, well, it depends on the client, it depends on this. It's like, you've got to be super clear. And the minute you're clear,
yes,
then people feel, they feel that you've got the you've got confidence, and they're much more likely to buy from you than the answer, you know. And it doesn't matter what it is, or if it's, you know, $100 or $1,000, it makes no difference. The difference is, you know, be absolutely certain and you know, name it. And the other thing that I really liked what you said was very much around the fact that so many coaches just have a problem putting themselves in a niche. And I say to them time and time again, the smaller the niche, the inch wide, mile deep, if you become the expert at whatever it happens to me. I mean, whatever it happens to be. I've got coaches that even though they're health coaches, they specialize in people with thyroid issues, or they specialize in people with menopause problems. Now, they're still health coaches. They can help you on any other part of health, but that's their niche. And as a result, it's really easy to place them, and it's really easy for them to get work.
Yeah, exactly. And I often like to say that ambiguity is kryptonite for a connector. If you're framing this as I can serve anybody, or this is for everybody, or any of those types of things, somebody like me, I can't help you because I know too many people. My brain is going to explode. I need to know, like, where are you focused? Because that's the only way I can remember, oh, I met this person who does this, or I met this person who's involved in that.
Yeah.
If it's too broad, it's so hard, yeah, to be able to come up with those connections and help.
Yeah, totally. So, Michael, tell us actually what you do with people. I mean, what is it that Small Pond Enterprises actually does?
Sure. So we mainly work with individuals who are having struggles around this networking and sort of connecting piece. And we look at things like, are they doing this kind of work of evaluating the network? Are they thinking more carefully about what they're actually putting out into the world, who they're spending time with? And then the other piece that we do a lot of work with people on, and we look at, is this piece on the messaging side of how easy is it to explain? Are you really packaging this well? Because that is a major factor in contributing to the spread of the content and of the material. But a lot of folks, I think, you know, the issue often is, they have this network around them. They have all these people that could potentially help them, but they're not doing anything to activate it, and they're not actually doing anything to really dig in and make something happen. And that's the focus of the work that we do, is really around getting you into this mindset of who am I already connected with? What is it that I have to offer? And how can I really just like blow that up to move into that thought leader direction, to be at that higher level, make bigger projects happen, get my message out to more people, and that dynamic.
And it's interesting because I know I also, you know a lot of people that go out and they network and network and network, and they come home with these piles and piles of cards and what are they, and they, you know, they just think that because they've got more contacts they're better, but actually, from what I'm hearing you say, it's the quality, not the quantity.
Oh, totally. And that's the thing. It's, you know, there's so many people who, they go out to these events, they do all these things, and they collect people, but everybody's treated the same. And because everybody's treated the same, they have no idea who is really helping them and who is potentially hurting them. So they have all these people around them and they're like, wow, I'm a great connector. I know tons of people. But their own business is struggling and sort of flailing. I call it connection rich and cash poor. And it's very, very easy for people to become connection rich and cash poor if you're not thoughtful about the curating process, if you're not thoughtful about the message that you've created and making it easy for people to share your message, you end up with a lot of challenges as a result of not doing those things.
That's so cool. I love it. I love it. Thank you, Michael. You talk such sense. You really do. And I just wish more people knew about you. I just wish more people actually really, you know, took on board. And it's not rocket science stuff, but it's just so powerful. And I love it. So, Michael, thank you. I really appreciate you coming and just spending this time with us. What we can do now is see if we can have a go with this. Okay. So anyway, I would just see if we can get some kind of signal going here, but apparently it's not working too well. So anyway, I'm going to give up on the technology. However, I'm not going to give up on you, and I thank you so much for the time, and it's just been brilliant. And thank you everyone for coming on board. I'm sorry we went over, but it's just such great information. I couldn't kind of stop myself. I wanted everybody to get the last drop of incredibleness from you. All right, Michael, thank you so much. And we will I will talk to you soon.
Sounds great.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks so much, guys.